sure.
After my conversation, hopefully we will have some inspiration statements at the end of the session. We in this room have an excuse for being curious about the protocol for Armageddon in Russia and China, because it's their firestorms from their weapons that threaten to destroy our country. Unfortunately, they're even less democratic than the United States, and there are no clear paths to reform their protocol to strengthen the checks and balances on the authority that has been vested in the leaders of those two countries, Vladimir Putin and Xi Jinping. Let me divide the discussion into the two countries. I start with Russia. Russia had, I could almost use the presentation I gave this morning and translate it into Russian and change a few names and present the same description of the Russian system. It's highly centralized in Vladimir Putin. And that's good in the sense that, as I said this morning, this protocol of centralization concentrates authority in the hands of the highest level of government, keeps it out of the hands of the military and others. This is an attitude. This centralized system reflects the core value of the Russian political culture going back to the Tsars, and that's top-down control. And it has continued beyond the Tsars into the communist era and into today. Stalin resisted putting nuclear weapons on missiles and aircraft and delivery systems, torpedoes and the rest, because he was afraid that those weapons would be used not only without authority, but possibly used against his own regime. And so there was a very strong separation between warheads and delivery systems that lasted through Stalin. But then it changed. And we know during the Cuban Missile Crisis that there were short-range tactical weapons deployed all over Cuba and on submarines around Cuba that had no real safeguards on them other than three-person consent control, and that were available for use at the discretion of fairly low-level commanders in the field. So there was a considerable loosening of this centralized control over the short-range weapons, and that continued on. I had the good fortune in the early 90s to spend several years full-time conducting research on Soviet and then Russian nuclear command and control. And as the Russian system disintegrated, particularly around the time of the coup attempt in Moscow in 1991, all kinds of people came out of the woodwork who wanted to talk about their nuclear weapons and their policies and their command and control systems. And so I was in a perfect position to learn a great deal about the operation of these forces. And I spent a lot of time in smoke-filled rooms in Moscow with Russians learning about how their system worked. Right after the coup, I brought one of these Russians, who was a colonel in the Strategic Rocket Forces, to Washington to testify before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee with me on safeguards during the coup on Soviet nuclear weapons. And the colonel testified essentially that the tactical weapons were pretty loose and unsafe, but that the strategic weapons were extremely well safeguarded with control at very top of the chain of command. And that was true then and it's true today. The system is on high alert. It is geared in the same way ours is to quick launch And it runs the same kinds of risks of inadvertence, of mistaken launch on false warning that we run in our system today. In some ways, the Russian control is weaker than ours, because it's still, that country still has not recovered from the debacle of the 1980s and 90s and into the 2000s, when their military essentially disintegrated. And so today, for example, the Russians have a very decrepit space-based system of early warning that effectively doesn't work. And so they rely on largely on ground radars to detect an attack, notify Vladimir Putin, and begin the protocol for retaliation. So that reduces the decision time for Vladimir Putin to 2 to 4 minutes, I calculate, compared to, say, 6 minutes in the United States. So the timelines there are extremely short. This whole process on both sides, frankly, it's very tenuous. I strongly doubt that it would actually work under the time pressures and time deadlines that we've been talking about, and that the protocols on both sides would collapse. That there would not be time needed to order retaliation. I'm talking about first use. There are no checks and balances, to my knowledge, on the Russian leader or the Chinese leader for first use. So the Russians, fearing a decapitation strike on their country, have in the 1980s developed a Dr. Strangelove-like apparatus called Perimeter. We call it the Dead Hand, which was designed to ensure that if Moscow and the top hierarchy of control of the Russian nuclear forces were decapitated, that a quasi-automatic system of rockets and command and control electronic equipment would ensure the quasi-automatic retaliation of Russian nuclear forces in response to an attack. Quickly on China, and then I'll wrap up. Again, I think China is highly centralized. Xi Jinping, as far as I can tell, has at least as much control and as few checks and balances on him as Donald Trump or Vladimir Putin have on them. China historically has had a policy of no first use, and it's reflected in the day-to-day operation of their forces, which is very low-key. The number of forces is very small. They don't believe in fighting nuclear wars, at least they haven't historically. And in fact, they have kept almost all of their nuclear warheads in storage at one location in China. They have dispersed very few warheads to field locations. That probably is in the process of changing as they deploy new submarines and land mobile missiles, but historically they have been a model of restraint in these terms. No first use. By the way, they've signed a no first use with Russia, agreement with Russia. Russia has no other no first use agreements, and in fact generally has a policy of first use. So the opportunity for the top leadership in Russia to exercise an option for the first use of nuclear weapons is very, I think, very high. And in fact, they have some very strange ideas about how nuclear weapons might be used first to end a war. They have a doctrine called escalatory de-escalation, or to use nuclear weapons, which is an escalatory move, for the purpose of frightening the opponent into standing down and ending its aggression. A very risky doctrine, obviously, that could well fail. So civilian leadership, to acquire a nuclear football, a laptop computer, kind of deal that would expedite the authorization for the use of Chinese weapons. A laptop computer like that is in the possession of Vladimir Putin. What he does is that is he sends a special code from his computer, which is controlled, which is, you know, he has a military aide and all the trappings of the so-called nuclear football with him. But he would send a so-called permission command from him to the general staff, to the Russian professional military, who would then execute his wishes either in a context of first use or second use. So, as I said at the beginning, we really have no leverage, direct leverage over any of this, obviously, far less than we have over our own system, and we have limited leverage there so far. Obviously, these are not democracies, and how do you change their policies to make it safer? The answer clearly is that we need to restore a relationship with Russia and China based on security, cooperation, and diplomacy, and work harder with them to further reduce nuclear weapons and to modify the operational practices of our nuclear forces so that they're not on the air trigger alert and do not depend on quick launch for their survival. So Global Zero, let me just end on this note, is an organization that I co-founded about almost 10 years ago that seeks to influence the nuclear weapons countries. This is in contrast to the Ban Movement, which basically is an organization of countries that exclude the nuclear weapons countries and have as their goal the adoption by the nuclear weapons countries in the entire world of their ban treaty. I think the process that is going to work, it will be one that's more incremental, step by step. It goes directly at the nuclear weapons countries to adopt measures such as the one that we heard about earlier today in their individual countries. And Global Zero has organized efforts along these lines of all the nuclear weapons countries, except North Korea. And we obviously have to tailor our efforts to each country, because there's no such thing as a grassroots campaign in China. But you can have Global Zero Chinese generals who believe in the elimination of nuclear weapons, who are part of our group, give interviews on Chinese media, and they're very well known and very successful in spreading the message to the Chinese people. Other kinds of strategies are tailored to other countries like Russia. So I think for Global Zero, I think one of the most important near-term steps that everyone can take right now would be to push for the adoption worldwide of no, not using weapons first, no first use. If countries were to adopt that position and adopt it and implement it in an incredible way, it would be extremely stabilizing for a crisis. If no belligerent believed that the other side would use nuclear weapons first, it would have a very stabilizing effect on confrontation. It would also set up the logic of zero, because if there is no point to use nuclear weapons except second, if the sole purpose of nuclear weapons is to prevent their use by other countries, and there's no opportunity or need or urge, pressure to use them first, then we're on a path for everyone to multilaterally negotiate a convention for the reduction and elimination of nuclear weapons. Because there's no point to happen if everyone else adopts the same policy. So that, I think, is the next step that makes the most sense, that would have the most impact, and I think is the most feasible. We had a Obama administration that came very close to adopting sole purpose as its policy. We now have apparently a reversal of that thinking in the view of policy by the Trump Pentagon. But nevertheless, we have other countries with no first use policies, like China, which has a universal policy, Russia has one with China only. India has a no first use policy. So we have a baseline of support for no first use that, if we can build momentum for globally, could produce